Hi everyone, I'm Nettie Kaye. Welcome back to my studio. And today we are going to be doing an oil portrait sketch on panel. It's a little bit bigger bite than we normally do, but let's go for it. I have a wonderful model from my We Da Vinci Art Academy here in McCall, Idaho. Evie is 5.5 years old and her mom has consented to let us paint her for you today. When you're painting or photographing a child or any subject for the purpose of painting, make sure that there is one direction of light, not just flash, not overhead lights, no, you know, just washing out of all the shadows. We want shadows. We want light, we want middle tone, we want shadows. Without all those three elements, the painting or the work of art is going to be rather flat and very dull, and frankly, I don't want to sign my name on it. All right, I said it. So I put Evie in the light of this window to where the light reflected on the side of her face, on the right side of her face, and there was shadow on the left side. And so this gives it a more, it'll look more Rembrandt-y than if I just took it with a flash. So, all right, so here's our panel, and I have done a little bit of a sketch ahead of time, primarily because I cannot paint right directly in front of it because I'm in the way. When you paint, be right in front of your work. I need a little bit of a mark so that I don't put the nose over here and the eyes over here. That's what happens if you're off to the side. You will cause things to go askew. All right, here we go. Now, with this particular technique, what we do is I'm going to take an interesting new type paint called Transparent Earth Red by Gamelin. It's a fast matte color, which means it's specifically for underpainting. It's not the last layer, it's for underpainting, and it dries very quickly. And also, it dries matte. So then the next layers that you put on once it's dry will be the glazing over the top. But this really works really well for this. All right, here we go. So here we go. I've got the drawing over here, and I've sprayed it down with aerosol, like White Rain hairspray. And you can find that at the drugstore, and it keeps the pencil mark from going anywhere. And I'm now going to cover this this board with some of this transparent earth red. And is that what that is? Transparent earth red from Gamelin. And we will see. They do make this in a few different colors. Some white, some, I think even in a blue. Again, they've just formulated this in the last 10 years, and so I decided I'd give this a shot. All right, and the paper towels that don't have the lint is the Viva paper towels. We're going to use a lot of those today, so I'll stick that real close where I can get it. And now I'm going to look at my photograph, and I'm going to try to find the lightest lights in the picture. Oh, first off, I want to kind of smooth this down. I don't want to have to deal with all the paint strokes. So let's do that. I'm going to smooth it down. And you may not be able to see the image underneath. It's just barely there. I've rubbed this off a few times already, and so it's starting to really fade out. That's okay. It gives us enough information that we can keep going. We know where her face is. Okay, so now I'm going to find this light right here, and I'm going to take my little towel and begin to wipe out the lights and the lightest parts that I can find with the little paper towel. And it doesn't have to be super accurate, but it just kind of helps us to establish all these wonderful lights on the face, and it goes really fast. I love fast. I don't have a lot of patience to keep messing around with things. Now, let's go with the nose. Little ball. Now, the nose is made up of a kind of a ball shape or a sphere. So if you'd like to learn a little bit more about how to make a sphere, you can go on to my videos on YouTube and go on, I think it's beginning, the beginning class, number 3 on how to paint a sphere. And it really helps in the long run so that you can figure out how to create all these various different shapes. We do a sphere and a cylinder, and we talk about color and materials. And so just go through those first 5 videos. I'm going to now take out the whites of the eyes a little bit. Another way to do this is to grab a Q-tip, and we use these in drawing and everything else in the kids' classes, and you can take out some of them with a little bit more accuracy. Now I'll come back in with that and I'll take out the top where that light hits the nose like this, and then down here, yeah, that works very well. It actually kind of shoves the paint over so that you get a bit of a weird shadow, but in the long run we'll get there. All right, and then I have a little part. The area underneath the nose is called a philtrum. And that's the that part that kind of separates the two sides of the flesh above the lip. And then here's a little muscle that kind of comes out underneath the mouth here. And there's a shadow underneath the lip, so I want to leave that as much as I can. And a shadow underneath the chin. The middle tones are happening on the other side of the face. And so I'm just still trying to just find the lightest lights and then kind of work out the middle tones as we go. That's about all I want to do at this stage. Isn't that interesting how it just begins to pop out? You can do this with things that are not necessarily portraits as well. You can use, you know, do it with still life and landscape, all kinds of different things. Okay, now the next part I'm going to do is I'm going to take some of that same transparent earth red, and this time I'm going to take it just straight, and I'll go in and find, I hope my brush isn't too bulky here, I'll flatten that out, and I'll find the nostril right here, and I'm trying to get the proper shape of the nostril. What I'm hoping to do, hoping I can control myself and not dive into a bunch of color right off the bat. I'm just trying to figure out what the tonal values are. Now, the old masters used to do this thing called a grisaille, and there are quite a few people that still do this, or they do this type of thing, where you paint what's underneath in black and white, a black and white study underneath. It's not really a study, it's an underpainting, and then you allow the underpainting to dry, and then you do glazes of transparent color over the top. And that's how you get this marvelous translucency of skin and different things. And so that's part of the reason we do this. Sometimes I think that the old masters did not really understand what they were doing. They just were doing it to conserve paint, but what they got in the end was this marvelous, you know, just beautiful translucency in the skin tones. They were just trying to save paint, but we have a lot of paint, but we can choose to do it the same way. All right, now I'm going to dive into a little bit of black. I don't use very much black, but I will in this tonal painting, and I'm going to find this the pupil. Pupil of the eye is closer to the lid, the upper lid, because she's kind of got that little childlike look, looking up a little bit. And I'm leaving a tiny chunk out of the very corner of that pupil so that we can put the highlight in. Now I'll put a ring around the outside, and yes, I know she has blue eyes and bluish kind of a gray-green combination, But really, I'm just trying to get the tone right now. So we'll give her a little bit of life with, make sure we get that right. And then I will go back into a raw umber and put in a little bit of a lash here. Not a lash, we're not doing the lashes yet. I'm just kind of shaping the eye a little bit. And then, let's see, we'll kind of give a little bit of a dark on the top of the eyeball. And then I'll give her a little bit of an eyelid. Don't forget the lids. And we'll do the same thing over here to this eye. I hope you can see this. And another little eyelid there. And just for your enjoyment, I'll put a little bit of an eyebrow on. I don't always start out by putting all these things on, but it just kind of helps you to see what it's going to look like a little bit later. Now I'll take a little bit of a wider brush. Got my brushes way over here. That's crazy. Pull them in a little bit. This is a half inch brush here, and I'm going to use a little bit of the raw umber along with our transparent red oxide, and I'll fill in, and I'm shaping this so that I don't have a bunch of lines. I've just got tones bumping up against tones. There we go. It's interesting, her hair isn't super dark, but the area where we have the kind of the roots and stuff is going to have a bit of a dark shadow. And so I'm going to find where all this shape goes. One of the mistakes that we make a lot of times is we make the top of the head too short. And we don't give our kids any brains. All of a sudden, everything's missing. And so we have to be very careful that we don't forget that the eyes will often rest at the halfway mark. This one, in fact, her hair is high, so she's even higher in some ways. Oops, I got to make sure I don't put that ear too low. Her ear is actually quite a bit higher than I would have anticipated, partly because her head is slightly tilted forward. You tilt your head up and down, it changes where your ears land. Okay, let's get some of that darker tone here so I can find. This is her hair. And also the shape of her neck right there. Now this is her neck will just, oops, better be careful of that one. The neat part about this is that you can come back in with your towel and you just re-wipe it out and everybody's happy. Okay, good. Now I'll get this going here. And the shirt is actually in a black, so I'm going to give a little bit of a shadow. See how far I go here. And it goes down like that. And make that nice and dark. I'm not worried about the little designs or the little hearts on the shirt. Paint the shirt before you paint all the designs. That's kind of critical. I probably won't finish that off at the bottom. I'll just make it kind of a vignette. I like that better. Like that. Okay, now let's see. Do I have anything else that's that dark? Let's look. Pretty dark over here. Every day when she comes into class every week, she has this wonderful French braid. I don't know how her mom does it. I wish I could figure it out and have her do mine. All right. Okay, now I'm going to come back in. I have another little tool called a rubber tip paint shaper. I'm pretty sure if you Googled that in on Dick Blick or Jerry's that they could probably figure that out for you. But I think it's actually a sculpting tool. I'm not sure. But I can come in and take out some of these highlights like that. You know, I can just go in and get a nice long curl and take out some of the highlights with my paint shaper. And it's just a fun thing that I discovered. I'm not sure, I don't know who else would use it like this, but I sure like it. And then I can, look how I can just make that hair just instantly look like it's supposed to be there like this. And it's got a point on one end and then a flat end, so I can even get some really tiny, tiny, tiny hairs if I want. Okay, now let's come back in, shape out the lights there. And now I can begin to put in some of the middle darks. And let's see how I can do that. I'm going to test this out. Put a little bit of white with my transparent earth. I'm going to add a little bit of thinner. And this will be just slightly darker here, and then the little shadow under the eye, and then what? How the nose stands out is not a line; it's a tonal value shift. See that? Here's a little shadow under there, and the bottom of the chin has a bit of a shadow as it turns back, and there's a little. Funny when you look at things, kids actually have these kind of dark areas underneath their eyes. Don't get too dark with stuff because then they will look a little bit older. And we'll give this a little definition there. And here's a little bit of the cheek as it goes under. Then I'll give it a little bit lighter, put a little more Gamsol or odorless thinner, and we bring it up just a notch tonally. If I get too dark, I just use the rag. There. And we'll shape out that lip just a little bit. Coming together. It looks so weird at this stage too. I mean, it just does. One of the strangest things, but in the end, ooh, it's yummy. You can see this is this area right here kind of almost has the same tonal value as where it hits the face. And it goes out into a bit of that warm. Not warm, we're not into color, into the clavicle area, and then we'll get a little bit, just a tad bit lighter right here, right there. Make sure you have that the right shape. I'll come back in. Here we go. I'm going to come back in with the little rag and take out anything that I think is misshapen. At some point, I'm going to come back in and get straight, flat in front of this so that I know that I've got it all correct. Okay, a neat part that we need to remember when it comes to the nose. See, it looks still pretty flat. There is on the a nose a shadow that is underneath the nose, so the ball of the nose kind of stands up a little ways. I make that a little ball. There's a little shadow. Mm-hmm. And a little shadow under that. All right. When you're doing the mouth, the upper lip is going to be darker than the lower lip. And the lower lip will catch a little bit of light right here. And the top of the chin will catch a little light. and she's kind of coming together. Now I'll get a little bit more of my thinner and begin to take my Q-tip and move some of this tone out just very carefully. I'm not pushing down on this Q-tip at all. I'm just kind of moving the color around. I want to get this a little bit darker on this side too, so let's see if we can do that. Remember, anything three-dimensional will have three tonal values. Dark, middle tone, light. Five is better. Dark, middle tone, light, highlight, and cast shadow is even better. See how that little cheek is sort of popping out a little bit. One of the trickiest tones is inside the white of the eye, and you just automatically think that the whites of the eyes and the teeth are white. Now, if you make them super white, what happens a lot of times is you end up with them just sticking out, and so they look googly, or your teeth look like they're, you know, just buck teeth sticking out. And so you have to be careful that you don't overemphasize something by making the tonal value too light. One of the ways of figuring that out is to isolate it by cutting a little hole in a piece of paper, just a tiny hole, and then holding it over your picture and looking at it without thinking about what it is that you're painting. You know, don't think about it as the white of an eye. Just think, what color is that? What's the tone of that in reality? And then match it with something. And you'll be surprised at how different it really is from what you thought it was. I have a hard time with tones. I'm a colorist, and so I love color, and I can nail color. I can match colors very, very easily. But tonal values take a tremendous amount of practice. And you can get better at it, but I don't think you can ever practice too much. Okay, here she comes. Now, one thing you gotta watch out. I don't wanna see a lot of lines because this is a little girl. The more lines you have, the older she gets. So what it is tones merging into tones. That's what you're looking for. So I'm going to take that and soften that out. There, now she looks 5 years younger than what I had her. There's a little muscle right here, and then this begins to come out. Isn't this fun? Wow. All right, so now I'm going to say don't do this at home. Don't paint with your fingers, especially if you're using cadmiums. This is not cadmium. This is an earth pigment. So I'm going to just take a little bit of this with my finger and blend it a little bit. Again, you can use Q-tips, and a lot of you guys wear gloves when you paint, and I don't blame you. I just have a hard time painting with that. Get that nice and smoothed in. It's a little bit like working with pastel or chalk. Very interesting with this particular paint. Again, I don't have a lot of paint on here, just barely any paint on here at all. And I've darkened that down just a tad. I've got too much actual white in the paint right here, so I'm going to take that back a notch and go back to our... make sure that shape is right too. It's weird. The more white you put on it, the more opaque your paint is, the less real something looks. It's just an odd little problem that happens. So you want to avoid that. I'm just going to come in with our transparent red again and shape that out. Now, I'm going to take a break. And what I'll do is I'm going to turn myself around, get in front of this thing, and finish it up to the point where I think we're ready for the next step. I'll be right back.
I'm back now,
And I have had a few moments, actually an hour and a half, of focusing quietly on the shapes and the tones of this portrait and working on just refining them back and forth, those darks and the middle tones and the lights. And I like what I see so far. Anyway, what do we do next? The next thing we do, we let it dry for about 2 days, 2 to 3 days, and then we'll meet again and we'll begin doing the glazing process of beautiful color over the top of this monochromatic little beginning. I hope you enjoyed this. I absolutely love sharing what I know. And if you want to hear about when the next video is going to come up, please subscribe. It's really important or you might miss out. It also encourages us to know that we're on the right track with what we're presenting. Thank you so much. And also, if you'd like to order a portrait for yourself, please go to my Etsy site at nettiekaystudio.etsy.com and you'll be able to order one similar to this. Just make your request known and I'm happy to do it for you. They're not that expensive and it would really be a joy to do one for you. All right, I'll see you a little bit later and we'll learn something new. Thanks, bye-bye.